If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife.
I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, where the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away.
Texas, oh, from sea to shining sea,
from Detroit down to Houston,
New York to LA,
where there's pride in every American heart,
and it's time we stand and say.
How wonderful a way to start this morning and to listen to that beautiful song done in such a inspiring and really cool manner that if you notice, they had all those little cameras from all across the country and people taking part in singing that song and singing about God's blessings, because God is truly who our freedom comes from and who our liberty comes from, right? Amen. And that is a continual prayer for us as Christians, that God would bless the United States of America as he guides us, because he is our light. He is the guiding light for us. Amen. Well, this morning, as we've come together in God's house, I've brought some words to hopefully bless your hearts with today as I meditated on some of God's word this week in my life. So good morning, and it is wonderful to see everyone this morning in the house of the living God. How blessed a time it is when God's people gather together in worship to praise the one true God, the God of all creation, the Father of mercies, the God of all comfort, the God who never fails, our eternal provider, our forever Savior, and our faithful friend that sticks closer to us than any other. How wonderful and awesome is our God. Let the people praise his magnificent name. Psalm 72 cries out and declares, "Blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who only doeth wondrous things, and blessed be his glorious name forever, and let the whole earth be filled with his glory." Amen, amen, and amen this morning.
Amen.
Thank you, Tom, and great to see you in church this morning, and welcome. We just had a
wonderful time in 9:30 service. Had a great crowd, good spirit. And man, we had people coming in, and the Lord really blessed. And here we are at the 11:30. And we're also, the 11:30 service, we have some other guests with us today. Some who are church members, some folks are in other states, and some are in other communities. And we want to welcome, let's let our Facebook folks know we're glad they're with us today. Yes, indeed. Welcome along for the blessing. Amen. And it's a great day. It's a fantastic day to be in God's house with His people. Welcome home to GBC this morning. We are glad that you are here. Life sometimes catches us a little bit on the short side, doesn't it? You know, we've had a whole lot of that happening here over the last several months. It can be humiliating to find ourselves needing help, but in these days in which we are living, we really need help. We need help today that only God and God alone can provide. Not so much help from the human aspect or the human hand, but help today from the divine hand of God, who is the supply of every need and who helps us through whatever we will face in life. We need the help that only God can give, and that help that He gives is full today of grace, and it is sufficient. So in Psalm 121, we're encouraged to trust God even when life, you know, it gives us what we haven't really asked for. We get a lot of those things happen sometimes, that life affords us things that we are not too excited about. But you know what? The Lord always sees us through. The Lord, who can be trusted, He'll help you in every point of your life through the journey that you're facing. Listen to the opening words of Psalm 121 as the psalmist declared, and this is called the Psalm of Ascent. And this is what King David said, "I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from which cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord which made heaven and earth." Now, the psalmist lifts up his eyes to the hills above and sees the one today who is not only the destination of our journey, but is also the strength along life's path in the journey that we face. In spite of the perils, in spite of the struggles and the trials that we face and that we encounter, the mountainous crags and the desert wastelands that we encounter, we can trust the Lord, church, in all things. The Bible never lies to us about claiming that today, that life is tough, but the Bible has never said that life was going to be easy. We've never gotten that, but we do have a promise that even in whatever the circumstance, God is two things, with us and for us. Amen. So Christianity is no free pass. There are no shortcuts to bypass the essential human experiences that we all go through. But somehow people get this mistaken idea that when they face trouble, as they always do, that they can come to the irrational conclusion today that the presence of trouble implies the absence of God. Nothing could be further from the truth, could it? I said, nothing could be further from the truth, could it? You can shelter yourself in the presence of the Lord, even in times of chaos and clamor and confusion. God is right there beside you, exactly where He's always been and exactly where He will always continue to be. He is the fortress today that we can run to whenever we feel frustration, uncertain fears, worries, or that we just feel flat afraid. He is the God who is always enough. And in Him today, we can place our confidence. So in the storms our nation is facing right now, in the storms that some of you are personally going through, may today we look to the God who has always been there. For God, several things. Think about this. God is always and still on the throne. God is still and always in control. God will hear your cry. So with God, here's the bottom line. With God, the bottom line is simply today, nothing is impossible with God. I said nothing is impossible with God. You can put your trust in Him, and oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. Here's a song. This is a great song. Goodness, Love, and Mercy, done by Chris Tomlin. I pray your heart will be richly blessed by this great song today. Isn't it?
What a great song. It declares promises straight from God's Word. It tells us surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow. It doesn't say may follow. It says will follow all of my days. Amen. Would you join me in prayer this morning as we come before the Lord in His house, as we enter into a season of worship, to ask His great blessing on everything that will happen in His house today. Father God, Lord, thank You so much for this beautiful day that You've given us once again to come to Your house, God. And Lord, thank You, Lord, for just as that song declared as we listened this morning, God, we are so thankful for Your goodness and Your love and Your mercy, Lord. We know Your mercies are new every day, God. And Lord, we know that Your goodness is sure. And God, we just thank You so much for it. We thank You, Lord, for holding us close to You and keeping us under Your beautiful wing, Lord, and just taking care of us. And God, we thank You again for leading us to Your house today, God, as we've come to enter into a spirit of worship, Lord. We pray that every heart will be open, ready to receive the word that You've given our dear friend Carlton to bring a little bit later in the service to share with us, God. But Lord, we just ask that You guide and direct everything that happens in Your house today. May it be pleasing to You, Lord, and may every heart be ready to worship You in spirit and in truth. And we ask this in Christ Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Welcome today to the house of the Lord, and I'm glad you're here today. In this changing times that we're living in right now, we've moved from the parking lot and drive-in church and 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And Tom and I was talking about it in between services that we almost got our times mixed up today. We still had the mentality of the 2 o'clock service, but we got here. All is good. And praise the Lord. We thank the Lord that we can have two services, 9:30 and 11:30. And one of these days we'll get back to, if there's such a word, as normalcy again. I don't know. But we have been doing a lot of planning and a lot of work. Tom and I met some last week and talked about some things, and again this morning, and some things that will be forthcoming. So get ready for some more and great blessings that God has in store for you. I have been on for over a year the book of Romans, and we've been going through week by week, verse by verse, chapter by chapter, and we got up to about the 8th verse of the 12th chapter of last Sunday, and I thought, I'm going to give the church a little time out. Just get away from the book of Romans for a week or two, and just give you a little refreshing time and another theme, another thought, and that's exactly what I'm doing today. And I'm in Psalm 1, if you'd like to follow along in your Bibles. And also, if you are at home or wherever you're at and you're watching this on Facebook, open your Bible. Just don't sit there and just listen. Get involved. Get involved with the worship. Amen. If you like what the preacher's saying or the song, even when you're in your home or wherever you're at, it's okay to say amen. And that's saying, yes, so be it. I agree with it. So we don't want you to get dried up while you're home. We want you to get energized and blessed. Amen. But we're in Psalm 1, and I'm dealing with the subject today, the forgotten grace on meditation. Now, that's an interesting subject. And we're in Psalm 1, the entirety of it. It's only 6 verses. I want to begin today by saying the Bible is not simply words about God. It is the Word of God. And so the Bible holds supreme authority by virtue of its author today, who is the king of creation and who is the ruler over all the earth. Listen, this world may be in a state of confusion and mess, but God's not. God's still in control because he's a sovereign God. And today God knows exactly what is going on. And today we can rejoice in that. We can also rejoice in the fact today that I believe the events that are taking place are leading up to the glorious and grand event that we are all sitting on the edge of our seat waiting for, and that's the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ for his church. And my prayer is the same that John had on the Isle of Patmos in the 22nd chapter of the book of Revelation. Even so, come Lord Jesus. Amen. So you find the commands of the Lord are radiant. And I thought about that word radiant. That's a good word to use on that. God's word radiates like heat and light. So they are sources of spiritual strength. They're sources of spiritual energy for our lives that today they will give us strength. We're going through storms and trials, and not only as a nation, but many of you and many of those who are watching today are going through trials in your life. Well, listen, this spiritual strength and energy that we get from God is what propels us through what we're facing, because God is with us, God is for us, and God has not abandoned us. God is there, and you can trust him today. God's word possesses dynamic power that produces change to everyone and anyone who will live in the environment that God has provided in his word. See, it all comes and boils down to this fact. You and I must trust the Lord in all things. In everything today, we must put our confidence in the Lord. Don't put your confidence in what all the media is saying. Don't put your confidence in what the world is saying. Don't put your confidence in what politicians are saying. Put your confidence in what God has already declared, because God is truth and all men are liars. Amen. So you can be assured you can stake your all today on the reliability of God's word. You can stand secure on every syllable that is in the pages of God's word that is contained in 66 books. It's all God, it's all truth, and it's all good. Amen. So God's word is, I liken it to radar. Some of you are familiar with radar. You're going down the highway doing about 90 miles an hour, and this little blue light special pulled up behind you. Well, that radar detected that you were violating the speed limit, right? It told what you were doing. Well, God's word is like radar that signals you that when you're in danger of straying off course today, you say, well, preaching out, just a moment. I have a conscience, and you know, I'm just going to put my trust in my conscience. So let me say this about your conscience and mine. Our conscience is inadequate. Amen. But God is adequate. Let me just say it this way. God is more than adequate today. Acts 20 and 32 declares and says, brethren, I command you to God, I commend you to God, and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among them all there which are sanctified. So God's word, I equate it to seed. I was telling the folks at 9:30, just here the last few months, I redid my front yard, and we brought in about 8 tons of topsoil, and Drew and I got up there and pitching dirt, throwing dirt. Couldn't get Tiff out there to do it, but we had to do it. Pitching dirt, throwing dirt, packing down dirt. Then we planted the seed. Well, guess what? I got grass. Yeah, my whole front yard is nice and green and pretty. But we have to plant the seed to get the grass. Now, that's pretty elementary. So look at it this way. God's word today is like seed, a potentiality in your life, in your heart, your mind, in your spirit. Amazing things happen when you study and you meditate on God's word, because you know what? Just like all my little grasses are coming up and waving at me and carrying on and looking green and good, you know what? You start to grow in the knowledge and the grace of the Lord. You start to develop. You start to be strong in God today. So your mind then illuminates, your heart resonates, and the truth comes to life in you. And all of a sudden, what has happened is now you are living a different life. Listen to me. You don't have to live and continue to live like you're living, down and out, ear tuned to the media, listening to every word that is being said, every lie that is being told. Why don't you open up the pages of God's word and absorb truth into your spirit that will make you strong in the Lord and in the power of His might? Amen. See, the Bible is more than just a doctrinal guide in God's word. The Bible creates faith. Faith then is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Faith, without it today, it's impossible to please God. It also produces change. It causes miracles. It will heal the hurts in your life. It will build character. It will transform your circumstances, and it will impart to you the joy of the Lord. Amen. I need all of that. And the church said, amen. It will overcome adversity, and it will defeat temptation, and it will build you up and anchor your soul in the hope that is found in God. It will even cleanse your mind and your heart, and it will bring things into being in your life, and it will guarantee your future with God forevermore. That's good news. See, there are some spiritual disciplines that we many times forget. These things that are happening right around us in our society, in our country, in our world, if you're not cautious, they can become very distracting to you. So all of a sudden, when you get distracted, you tend to forget what you're talking about. You ever talk to somebody and they got distracted and they forgot what they were talking about, and they turn to you and they say, "What was I talking about?" Yeah, some of y'all do that, don't you? You ever do it, preacher? Well, there's been an occasion, yes. These are core. You understand something here. There's some core principles that are involved in our life, and things that I can't understand why Christians can't get victory in. One today about, you say, "Well, I try to read the Bible." You don't have to try to read it. You can read it. "Well, I try to come to church." You don't have to try to come to church. You need to come to church. And not only that today, but folks, we can pray. "Well, I try to call on the Lord when I think about it." No, you need to call on the Lord all the time and be in an attitude. That's why Paul said, you pray without ceasing. These are core, key biblical disciplines that we need in our life. What these disciplines do, it will make you then a disciple of the Lord. It will enrich your life that you are stronger for the Lord. So there are disciplines today, and that's what these disciplines do. They're connected today that you read your Bible, you pray, and you come to church. If you can't get victory in those three areas, well, tell me how in the world you're going to get victory anyway. You can't do it. These are the things that will develop you to be the person that God has called. You can read all the books. You can read all the motivate. You can listen to the tapes. You can watch the CDs. I mean, listen to the CDs and watch the videos. You can go to YouTube and watch everything on there. But I'm going to tell you, if you're not applying the Word of God, you are weaker than water. And we need churches to be strong in the Lord. We need preachers to preach the gospel. We need Christians to live the gospel. Amen. And the church said a hearty what?
Amen.
That's better. Psalm 1, 6 verses. You can remain seated and you can follow me if you have your Bibles. Blessed. I like that word. Anybody like to be blessed in here? That's what I thought. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be, I love this. Now let me just say something. This bunch that says this is prosperity, this is not prosperity gospel right here. This is not worldly. This is God's word. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. Listen to what happens. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly, note those two words, shall perish. The way of the ungodly shall perish. So here's a proclamation from God's word, the very first psalm of 150 psalms. If you will take this proclamation of God's word and apply it to your life, I'm going to tell you, your life is going to be different. You're not going to be dragging through life, and you won't be using all the cliche, well, I'm trying to hang on. I'm trying to get through. I'm just trying. No, you can't do nothing, but God in you can do all things today, and you can rise above whatever you're in today with assurance and confidence and stability that God is with you today. Amen. I'm terribly concerned that the church, I'm concerned today that Christians have discarded the real values of God's word. We know just enough to be dangerous. Amen. We're caught up in a pandemic. We're falling apart. We're worrying about what the CDC is going to say next. Well, if you're putting your confidence in the CDC, your confidence is very shaky. Amen. We're caught up in all the racial strife that our nation is experiencing right now. We're caught up in the cultural chaos that we're going through. We're caught up, and when you're caught up in these things, you know what you're caught up in? The world. You're caught up in the world and what the world is saying. But listen, there is one answer to everything, and the unfortunate part is we as Christians, as church people, are ignoring what God is saying. Everyone, you know, wants to be happy, right? These are not the most happiest times that we're living in. I've heard people say, boy, I sure will be glad when this year's over. Well, you may carry some of the garbage from this year right on into the next year. You never know. And who would ever have thought last year this time that we'd be going through what we're going through now? But I'm going to tell you something. There's a God in heaven who wrote a book called the Bible, who's on time every time, and who's watching over his people and will see us through whatever we face. We can put our confidence in him. We want to be happy today, and we perceive, well, my desire, I deserve to be happy. Then we conceive today that do whatever it makes your soul shine. Well, the bottom line is everybody wants to be happy. Don't you? That's all right. Say amen. Don't you want to be happy? Even in our Declaration of Independence, and this weekend we're celebrating Independence Day, you find the words life, liberty, and the what? Pursuit of happiness. Everything we do is arrowed at the target of happiness. The problem is, we often lack happiness. You know why? Because our happiness, looks like I'm going to drift a little bit here. Tiffin told me, she said, watch it. She's been working on me to keep me tied to a pulpit, I guess. But anyway, it's hard, folks. I tell you, it's hard. I'm wandering here a little bit. Amen. I think I'm all right. But listen, we are in a position today that we're lacking the happiness that we really desire. We're living in fearful times. These are fearful times. Now, I know that there are the skeptics who say, oh, it's nothing but a bunch of baloney. I'm not sure about that. And I don't think we can gamble. That's one reason why we have done what we have done since the last Sunday in March, to provide you a safe environment to come worship in. 3 months in a parking lot. Now we've moved inside the building and we got pews roped off and we got asked you to socially distance yourself, and you're doing all the things. You've done well. Give yourself a hand. You've been doing pretty good. So don't blow it now, okay? But we're living in very fearful times in reality. And we see today that here is they talking about, and just this past week, we saw the numbers spike up on the coronavirus. And another outbreak, and they're saying, well, you know, these events and things that are going on and all this, you know, the reality is you need to take precaution and protect your health. And I'm going to advocate that, to take care of your health. God gave it to you and expects you to take care of it. Amen. Also, there's anonymous type sections, these cities that are setting up these areas called CHOP. And where basically it's just a season and section of chaos and confusion. We're living in a time where there's bloodshed, there's looting, there's friction. Today, we're living in division amongst our races. We're living in division amongst people. We're living in divisions amongst states and federal government. We're living in division between our House and our Senate. We're living in division in our locales and in our state. I mean, you look around and you see so much division today. You see also, because of the uncertainty and the fearful times that we're living in, I'm giving you some realities here. This is not something that's not real. It's real. People are lacking revenue. They're losing jobs. They're struggling to feed their families. Is all that real? You bet it's real. You think it's hard? You bet it's hard. It's tough times. But this is not the time that we discard the core values of what God has put before us in His Word. This is not the time that we ignore God, nor His Word, nor prayer, nor His house. This is the time, man, we grab it and cleave to it and let Him hide us in the cleft of the rock and protect us there with His hand, and know that our God is a God of provision, of grace and mercy, and God will get us through it. Amen. Amen. See, when you come to God's Word, there's a certified and qualified hope. My hope is not the fact that I crossed my fingers and hope and closed my eyes and hope I got through it. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. That's where my hope is found. And the Bible reeks with the blood of Jesus. Amen. So the first word in Psalm 1 is the word called blessed. Blessed is the man. Blessed is the person. When he speaks of gender there, he's talking about people who trust the Lord. That word blessed is interpreted meaning happy. So what God is proclaiming here is he's really today, and what he provides for us is the key to happiness today. And this morning, I'm going to show you the happy person. I want to show you the person that you can be. First, the psalm begins with a caution that so many are inclined to pursue today. You know, we're consumed with and we're watching the ways of the world. Some of you are so glued to CNN and HLN and Fox News and all the news media, you can't go a day without plugging yourself in to hearing all these bobbing talking heads tell you a bunch of junk that probably 99% of it is nothing but a bunch of baloney anyway. You get so inclined to the things of the world. You know why you're inclined to the things of the world? Because those are the things that you are pursuing. You got your mind on the world. You better watch today the way of the world. Instead today, listen and see, and you know the way of the world. There's a better way, and it's God's way. And you can trust that. Don't follow the way of the world to happiness, because you will be disappointed. God has a way to happiness, and if we will follow it, He will bless us. Amen. So the way of happiness is by the way of the word, not the way of the world, that comes by the way of an old-fashioned cross that Jesus died on to provide our salvation and the hope that we have today. Amen. We are to delight ourselves in the word. Amen. Not in the world, in the word. However, to be honest, we struggle with delighting, don't we? You know, the critical key, the forgotten factor today, the lost link between reading your Bible and actually having joy is the fact of this one word that we're not doing, and it's called meditating on the word. Your expression says, what? Meditation? Meditation? Thomas Watson said this, the reason we leave the Bible cold is because we never warmed ourselves in the fire of meditation. And you know what? I've got to agree with Thomas Watson. The plea today, the theme is this, fight for delight with meditation in the word. Amen. So you've got to take serious the gift of the meditation that you need to involve in your life. What do you got to do? About three things here, and I'll give them to you quickly. So buckle your seatbelt and hang on. One, you got to fill your mind. You got to secular meditation. This is what secular meditation tells you. It tells you to empty your mind. The scripture meditation tells us spiritually we are to fill our mind. See, you need today to fill your mind with the things of God. And you need to fill your mind with the word of God. You know what that does? That pushes all this worldly mess out of your mind. And so we must fill our minds with the truth. And when our minds are on the truth, then our minds is on the power of the word of God. Colossians 3:16 gives us this encouragement. He says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. So these are the things today, and there are three different ways that we can fill our mind in meditation. One, fill your mind cautiously. You've got to be cautious. Psalm 1 starts with today some things not to do. It starts with seemingly a negative, but God turns that negative into a positive. We delight today in what we meditate on. If you're meditating on the world, you know what? You're going to be disappointed and not delighted. When you walk in the counsel of the wicked, you know what you're doing? You're entertaining bad advice. Anybody ever giving you bad advice? Yeah, we all have. We've given it and we've received it, haven't we? But listen, we don't need the advice of the world today. You can't flirt today with non-truths. You've got to be careful what you're putting in your mind that will affect your life. So when you flirt with non-truths today, you will then begin to entertain the wickedness that is in this world. Folks, you investigate it, you then participate in it, and then you celebrate the fact of ungodliness in your life. In other words, you've gone the way of the world instead of going the way of the word. So the godly person does not live this way. The happy Christian fills their minds today with something different. We've got a better way. We've got something more blessed today. Be careful what you watch. Some of you, your remote may be walking you right into the counsel of the wicked. Be careful what you put in your mind. Also, your friends may be standing today in the way of sinners. Be careful of your social media today, because let me tell you what, a lot of the junk that I see on social media is nothing but garbage. Amen. And when you're absorbing that stuff, you are sitting in the seat of scoffers. When you're putting this stuff, you know what a lot of it is? A lot of it is gossip, garbage. Amen. I don't read it. Don't have time for it. As the woman said, I ain't got no time for that. Amen. Fill your mind cautiously. Some of you will catch it. Fill your mind correctly. The psalmist says, he fills his mind with the what? Law of the Lord. What's the law of the Lord? That's the word of God. So the word law, it means Torah, which means instruction. So you need right instruction, right? You need right instruction that will get you to the goal that God has for your life. Therefore, it's talking about the Word of God. When you fill your mind, your heart, your soul, your family, your church, your life with the Word of God, your life is going to be different. Amen. God's going to bless your life. You are to meditate. Listen, church, you need to start meditating on the Bible. Amen. Be careful how you approach the Word. Some approach the Word superficially. We want to find what is good for us to hear, and that's all we want to read. We also tend to have super spiritual reading where we take the Scripture and we somewhat pull from it something that's not there. We also read the Word of God in a self-absorbed way. We think the Bible is about us. You better rethink that. Thank God God included us, but the Bible is about the God of heaven. In the beginning, God. And it's always been and shall always be God. But aren't you glad He made a way and provided a means where we today could be a part of what He is doing? Amen. So we think about the Bible today. We better start thinking about the God of the Bible. Your Bible interpretation must be correct. Secondly, ask, what does the Scripture mean? We need to seek what the Bible is teaching about God and about ourselves. You know what the Bible says about us? We were alienated, separated, enemies of God. That doesn't sound good. But God made a way where there was no way. But God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Where we were shattered, broken, and in a mess and going to hell, God said, I'll send my only begotten Son, and He'll die on a cross, He'll pay the price, and I'll offer salvation to everyone who will come to me. Then fill your mind continually. The reason we meditate regularly is because we are prone today to lack focus. You ever talk to somebody and they got distracted? And they forgot what they were talking about? That's embarrassing, isn't it? And it's really embarrassing when you got to say to that person you were talking to, what was I talking about? Amen. You lack focus. And the reason you lack focus is because you're distracted. The psalmist said in Psalm 119, we must fix our eyes on God's ways. And that's why we are losing ground in America. We're not fixing our eyes on God's ways. We're prone to forget the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We are to reflect on God. We are to reflect on His Word. And you will never today modify your habits if you today leave God out of the equation. Also today, you've got to, here's one for you, you've got to learn to memorize God's Word. I didn't hear one amen. Let's try that again. I hope somebody in Facebook land said amen. You've got to memorize. We're giving you the tools to do it with. Every month we're putting out these Bible reading guides where you can read through the Bible. You know, we're still doing that. They're available. As you go out the door, they're available for you today. Oh, there also is a Bible memorization scripture for you to memorize. Are you doing it? Well, preacher, you know, it's just the, I'm just, that's all. No, you are losing your focus. Spend time in God's Word. How much clearer can I say that? If you're not in the Word, how do you expect the Word to get in you, right? You've got to spend time and meditate on it, ponder on it, and you've got to do something else today. You've got to muse today. I didn't say a musing. I said muse. You've got to muse over the Bible. When you muse over the Bible, you are thinking or you're pondering over God's Word. You know what happens when you read it? You'll start remembering things that you read. I mean, God will wake me up sometime in the middle of the night, but it's something I read. Or He'll put something in my spirit, you know, that I read someplace in time that I needed it. So when you modify, memorize, and muse today over God's Word, your life will begin to change. And you know what happens then? The power of the Bible takes root in your life. Amen. Second thing you got to do is fixate your heart. Before you can be happy in anything else, you must first be happy in the Lord. Are you happy in the Lord today? Don't say amen just to say, to make the preacher think you that way. Are you really happy in the Lord? Amen. All right, some of you need to work on that. Before you can be happy in anything else, you've got to be happy in the Lord. So the way you get happy in the Lord is to meditate on God's Word. Fixate your heart for stability. The Word of God will give you stability. It holds you on course, amen. You will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Your roots will be deep into the depth of the Word of God, and you will have strength and stability. That's what gets you through what you're facing. Amen. Fixate your heart for sanctification. God changes you from the inside out, because salvation begins as an inside job. You must cleave to the cross. You've got to get into the Bible, and you've got to let God today start doing a change in your heart and your life. Then sanctification means you're just set apart to glorify God that produces. See what sanctification does? Here's what it does. It changes you. And some of us need to be changed more and more and more, and we need to be continually changed by the power of God's Word. Fixate your heart today for sustenance. God's Word will keep you. God's Word will help you. God's Word will give you hope in the winter places of your life, the barren places, the hard places. We got some folks going through some tough battles right now. But you know what? They have today put their trust in the Lord. And God is going to bring them through. Today, God planted you through salvation. And I'm here to tell you today, God will sustain you, amen, through whatever you face. Nothing is too big for our God, amen. Praise God. And fixate your heart for success. When whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. This is not temporary. This is not that superficial prosperity gospel mentality that's sweeping across the church today. This is an eternal prosperity today that anchors you in God and gives you a fixation on him, that God is important and he's in your life. When you meditate on God's Word, you're going to be stabilized. Amen. You go through and you'll get through what you face because you are trusting the Lord. So when you meditate on God's Word, you know what? You will find success. And you know where success comes? It comes from God. And you will get it through the eyes of God. Third thing, and I'm through, is focus on the future. The stakes for the future is one of two things, life or death. The only way you're going to escape spiritual death is to receive spiritual life. Nicodemus came to the Lord Jesus Christ in the cool of the evening, and he says, you know, what's this thing about salvation? Jesus said, you must be born again. I don't understand. How can a man enter into the womb of his mother the second time and be rebirthed? And Jesus said, that's not the birth I'm talking about. I'm talking about a spiritual birth. And see, you've got to be, yeah, you're physically here. You have been born into this world. That's evidence right now, but you being here, your physical presence. But you need a spiritual rebirth. You need to be born of the Spirit. How do I get it? You give your heart to Jesus. It's simple. You recognize you're a sinner. You realize Jesus died for you on the cross. And third, you receive him into your heart and your life. How do I do that? God, forgive me of my sin of rejecting you. Come into my heart. Come into my life and save me in Jesus' name. Woo! And he will save you. And if you're not saved, that's your greatest priority right now. Not the pandemic, not the issues that are going on in our nation, your soul. What have you done with Jesus? You got to remember, judgment is coming, friend. This is just a prelude of what is to come. We think, man, it's really been tough over the last several months, preacher. This has been a cakewalk to what it's going to be. This is not even a dent in the paint to what it's going to be like when Jesus comes back for his church, and this world is in 7 years of tribulation. You better get your life straightened out, friend. And there's only one that can get your life straightened out, and that's giving your heart to Jesus and serving him and meditating on the Word today. Over 2,000 years ago, Jesus came. He paid the price. He took our death. He took our sins, and he paid it all in full. Listen, have you come to him in salvation? If not, I invite you to him today. The way of the world is wide and wicked and wayward, but the way of the cross leads home. Amen. The way of the Word is narrow and straight. And friend, one day, I promise you this, on the authority of God's word, Jesus Christ is coming back. He's coming, and the Bible says, in the moment and the twinkling, I just snapped my finger. Quicker than that, Christ will come. What happened if he came today? Oh, he's not coming. Oh, really? In the time that we think not, Christ will appear. As in the days of Noah, so it shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. I tell you, you can't tell me you'll see tomorrow. But I can tell you one thing. If I don't see tomorrow on this side, I'll see tomorrow on the other side. I know in whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I know that I know Jesus. Can you say that today? And then today, are you serving the Lord? Are you faithful to God? Because see, there's a judgment for the lost, and that judgment for the lost means damnation because you did not accept Christ. But there's a judgment for the believer of how you lived your life from the point of salvation to the point that you stand before God. So let's just pretend Jesus came back in the next 5 minutes. You had to stand before him. Let me ask you, what would he say to you? How would Jesus respond to you? How would you respond to his question? So how are you serving me? Well, Lord, there's no wells about it. You either have or you haven't. Why don't you set your sights and your sails today? Today, you're going to start getting in the word and getting in the walk and getting in the living that God has for you today. You can come to him today and bring your burdens. He can cast them all on him and he'll take them. You can come to him today and give yourself to him in salvation. You can come back to him if you've drifted away from him. See the choice, the way of the world or the way of the word, which is Jesus. What's your choice? What's your choice today? Would you bow your heads for a moment? You can come to Jesus because he loves you. And today he cares for you. Pastor, I've never asked Christ into my heart and my life. I've never accepted Jesus as my personal Savior. Oh, you may have called on the Lord in time of difficulty and thought, well, but you really was not calling on the Lord. I mean, have you really called on him and meant business for your salvation? Would you pray this prayer with me right now where you're at? Dear God in heaven, I'm lost. I need Jesus. Forgive me of rejecting you. Come into my heart. Save my soul. Make me your child. Thank you, Lord, for saving me in Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer a moment ago, would you just slip your hand up right where you are and say, Preacher, I ask Christ into my life. Anyone? Pastor, I ask Jesus, thank you. Anyone? How about you watching? Have you accepted him as your Savior today? Why not today? Let's stand to our feet. If you got burdens and needs and struggles, if you just need to come and refresh yourself in the Lord, rededicate yourself, you just need to come and talk to the Lord, you need to come and cast all the struggles that you're going through right now and just give them to God, this invitation song is for you. You can come just as you are, and God will change your life today. Father, move on our hearts and draw us to you. Bring us to altars. Bring us to a place today that you are at, that we can call upon you and experience the power we can today have true joy and happiness that is only found in you. Would you come? Come on. Come on. Come on. Is your life all it could, should, and ought to be for Christ? Come on. Could you be a better Christian? Come on. You need help, you need direction, you need strength. Come on. Whatever God wants to do in your life, will you let him do it right now? Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on.